a great honor and great pleasure to introduce Professor Lori B. Brenner to and to have her here at York. I got the task of really mentioning just some of your accomplishments. The list is endless. It was hard to pick a few things, but I'll mention some of them. So Professor Brenner is Professor of Computer Science at Carnegie Mellon. She's the director of the Sci-Lab Visible Privacy Security Library there. And she's also co-director of their master's program in privacy engineering. She served as the chief technologist at the U.S. Federal Trade Commission. She's co-founder of Wombat Security Technology Training Company. She has authored over 150 research papers and co-edited a book on security and disability. She's a founder of a very exceptionally known and famous symposium on usable privacy and security SOAPs. She also chaired the Platform for Privacy Preference Project and authored a book on privacy with PPP in 2003. In her younger days, although I don't know how much younger could be, she was honored as one of the top 100 innovators, 35 and younger. She's also an ACM Fellow and IEEE Fellow. And again, the list goes on and on. I'll also say that in addition to all these career-related accomplishments, what I've seen from her website, Professor Brenner is an excellent quilter, and she's the mother of three. So that's just a quick intro.
Thank you. As much as I would like them off to their own machine, and there they can run automated attacks, automated guessing attacks, and they can make, you know, trillions, billions of guesses to try to crack passwords. And so that's going to be our focus. Now, there have been many password breaches where attackers have actually done these offline attacks. And here are some examples of the companies that these attacks have happened to and how many users were affected. And you can see it's in the millions of users who are affected in these attacks. Just to recap how these attacks work. So somehow somebody gets that hashed or encrypted file. The attackers will go and basically make a guess as to a password. They will run it through the same hash function. They'll see if it's on the list. If not, they'll make another guess, run it through the hash function, see if it's on the list. And they can use specialized hardware. It turns out that the graphics hardware used for gaming works really well for password cracking as well. Not very expensive even, and you can do billions of guesses per second. If you have a good cracking algorithm, you're not just going to go in alphabetical order, but you're going to guess the most likely password first, and I'll show you a little bit of that. And one of the things you can do in defense to slow the guessing, if you are an organization who has passwords, is that you can use hash functions that are optimized to be slow. That's usually the opposite of what we want in computer science, but in this case, you have a function that is purposefully takes a long time to compute, then you can slow down the attackers because they can't make billions of guesses a second. They might only be able to make thousands of guesses a second, and that's going to really help a lot. All right, so the dumb attacker in this scenario is going to go in alphabetical order and guess every password. But it's going to take a long time because how many people have AAAD as their password? Right, that turns out, there's someone. It turns out that that's the most popular password. A smart attacker is going to use data to make guesses first of the more popular passwords. And so these passwords here are well known to be more popular passwords. And how do we know this? Well, there are a lot of passwords that have been stolen and then posted to the internet, and attackers or researchers or anybody can look through them and see what passwords keep appearing over and over again in these stolen password data sets. And these are examples of passwords that appear over and over again. All right, so you might wonder, well, if the attacker already has the whole password file, why do they even need to crack it? They must have gotten into the computer to get that file. Well, so it turns out, though, that most of us use the same password on multiple systems. So if the attacker can crack these passwords, they can go try them on other computer systems and now compromise other accounts. And this can and does happen. And that's what the attackers are after. So one way of slowing this down, besides using the slow hash functions, is to get users not to be so predictable. We want users not to choose those really common passwords. So one of the things that our lab has been looking at is how can we help users pick these good passwords that they're still going to be able to remember, but are going to be harder for the attackers to guess. So we first started getting interested in this when our university came out with the new password policy. And this is a screenshot of the password policy they came out with about 8 years ago. And they went from having a password policy that pretty much let you choose anything as a password to this one, which requires at least 8 characters, an uppercase letter, a lowercase letter, a digit, and a symbol, and then all sorts of other things that can't have too many of the same character and things like that. And we were curious why this policy. Where did this come from? And so we went and talked to the Information Security Office at our university, and they said, the university has joined this consortium of universities, and we are all following these guidelines. And so then we looked at the guidelines. Where did the guidelines come from? They came from a document from the US National Institute of Standards and Technology. So we went and we read the NIST guidelines, and there we found an interesting statement that said basically, we don't have any data, we're just speculating. And we looked at that and we said, well, wouldn't it be nice if we had some data here so that we could actually have password guidance based on actual data? And we were young and naive and we said, well, that sounds like a good research project. We're going to go get ourselves some password data. All right, so I'm going to tell you about some of the ways that we got passwords data and some of the methods that we've used in our user studies. And how we applied that to trying to find good password composition policies. And then I'm going to talk about passphrases, and then perceptions about passwords, and then password meters feedback and guidance, and then password expiry, how often should passwords expire, and then we'll wrap up. So that's the plan. So starting with the password study method. So how can you get passwords to study? The most obvious thing is to do an experiment and ask people to create passwords as part of your experiment. You can do this in the lab, you can do this online. And the problem with this approach is that you don't know whether the passwords people create are really like their real passwords. They might be behaving differently just for the experiment. If you do this in a lab, you also can't get very many passwords. If you do it online, it can scale and you can get a lot of passwords. So another approach is to get people's real passwords. So you can get stolen passwords. Hopefully you don't steal them yourself. But there are plenty of other people out there who are happy to steal them and post them to the internet, but you can just acquire those stolen passwords. And in our lab, we have acquired many, many but you are acquiring passwords from a thief. You don't really know where it really came from. You're taking a thief's word for where the passwords came from. So it's unclear how reliable this data is. It also tends to be fairly noisy. There's all sorts of other garbage usually mixed in with the data set. And you don't really know like when were these passwords created, how long did people had them, what did they do with them. And so it's a good starting point, but still not the best data set. You can also do surveys and ask people for their password. Hopefully they won't actually give you their password on a survey. But what we've done is surveys where we ask people about their password. How long is your password? How many symbols are in your password? Things like that in order to get some data. And then finally, you could get legitimate access to actual passwords. We thought that would be a great idea. We went and we asked a bunch of companies, can you give us access to your passwords? And, well, predictably, they're like, no. Why would we do that? But we did eventually get some access to passwords, and I'll tell you about that. Okay, so most of the password data we've used has actually come from large-scale online experiments. And we've been using Amazon Mechanical Turk. How many of you are familiar with Mechanical Turk? For those who aren't, this is a service that is run by Amazon.com where you can post a survey or a small task and offer to pay people to take your survey or do your task. And so you can pay, so a dollar for somebody to do your survey. So you can pay Amazon $1,000 and say, I want 1,000 people to do this task. And then after they do the task, Amazon will give each person a dollar. And it saves you having to figure out how to send a dollar to 1,000 people. So this has been a useful tool for us. We studied more than 40,000 participants. I think we're up to, at this point, more than 80,000 participants that we have studied through Mechanical Turk over the past 8 years or so. Another nice thing about it is that we don't actually have to collect any personally identifiable information from these people, and we can contact them through the Amazon website without actually having to have their email addresses. So we have a study protocol, and we've done variations on this over and over and over again for 8 years. Basically, people come and say they want to do our task, and we ask them to create a password. And depending on what conditions we've assigned them to, it might be any password or it might be restricted. They might have to create a password that's 16 characters long, or has to have symbols and digits, or whatever. Immediately after that, they take a survey, they try to remember their password, and then 2 days later, we email them and ask them to enter their password again and take another survey, where among other things, we ask them whether they wrote down their password. We are able to collect the plain text of their password, so we don't have to crack them, we know their password. We have survey data where we ask them questions like, how fun was this, how annoying was this, how frustrating was this, so we have their sentiment. And then we also know, we have all their keystrokes. We know how long it took them to create the password, we know if they hit the back key, tried again, we know how long it took them to type it in later, and things like that. So this gives us a bunch of usability metrics, in particular the creation time, the number of attempts, the number of recall attempts, their reported sentiment. A really big one, it turns out, is whether they wrote down the password. That actually gives us a lot of useful information. And then also the study dropout rate. How many people, when we email them 2 days later, don't actually come back? We find that even though we tell them that it's okay if you forgot your password, there's actually kind of a correlation between if people think they're not going to remember it, they're less likely to come back 2 days later. We also need a metric to measure security. And before we started doing this work, there wasn't a good metric to measure password security. Some people were using entropy as a way of measuring it, but entropy works well for large tests, but not something short like a password. And so we came up with a metric of guessability. And guessability is basically how many guesses will it take a typical attacker to guess your password. Now this depends on what algorithm the attacker is going to use, and since many of the password guessing algorithms are based on using machine learning, you train up your algorithm, then it's also dependent on what training data you feed your algorithm. And training data is generally stolen passwords that are available to you. But nonetheless, we can come up with an approximation of the guessability of passwords. We can run through many different algorithms as well. And so we have a guess number, or we say beyond the cutoff, which is basically more guesses than our algorithm is going to make in a reasonable amount of time. So in many of our studies, we used 380 trillion guesses, which is something that we thought an attacker with a single machine could do in 1 day. Actually, some of our more recent studies, but I think we've gone even higher than that. So here's an example. The password 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, that might be the fourth password that someone will guess. Password 178 is going to take 10 to 6 guesses, and this completely random password would be beyond the cutoff of what our algorithm would guess. So that's how we studied passwords using Mechanical Turk for this large-scale online study. What about getting real password data? The only organization that was willing to give us password data was our own university. So we managed to convince our university to give us passwords for over 25,000 faculty, staff, and student accounts, as well as over 17,000 deactivated accounts. Now, they didn't actually give us the passwords. They allowed us to run our algorithms over those passwords. We never saw or touched any passwords. Now these are important passwords. This is the single sign-on for email, financial information grade, registration, health insurance, all the stuff at the university. That's your main university password. And it follows the password rules that I showed you before, beginning with 8 characters as well as lots of other requirements. Besides getting access to the passwords themselves, we were able to get access to information related to the users of those passwords. So we had 7 months of web authentication logs, so we could see how many times each password was used over a 7-month period, as well as how many times people tried to log in with it and failed. In that 7-month period, we had a lot of logins, so it ranged one and about 3,500 volumes per user that was in that data set. We also had the age, gender, and department affiliation of all the people in the data set. That was de-identified somewhat, so you know, if you have one woman in a particular department, like she wouldn't be identified directly. So there was some doing there. And then we also set up a survey. So anybody who changed their password during that study period was, after they changed their password, was asked to fill out a survey. And so we have that survey data as well from about 700 participants. There were actually more people who changed their password, but not all of them completed the survey. Okay, so setting up this study was really difficult. It actually took us about 2 years to do this study. The first question was, how are we going to get access to passwords? We had assumed that, like in most systems, the passwords were hashed, and so we weren't quite sure how we were going to get access to them. We started talking to the system administrators and found out they were actually encrypted, not hashed. The important difference being that a hash is a one-way function and encryption is reversible. So if the passwords are encrypted, that means that if you have the right decryption key, you can decrypt them and analyze them. So we were able to do that. The university has changed their policy. It is actually much better to hash passwords than to encrypt them. But at the time, we were able to do that. We wrote code that did our password analysis, and we handed it over to the Information Security Office. They audited it. And then they put it on a machine not connected to the internet, and they put the password on that machine, decrypted it, ran our code. Our code actually took several weeks to run because of all the machine learning algorithms that were running over it. At the end, it spit out some data. They then audited the data to make sure it wasn't leaking information, and we finally got that data. Along the way, we had all sorts of problems, like we tried to run it and it blew up. And we weren't allowed to actually see the computer it was running on, and so it was very difficult to debug. We eventually bought an identical computer and generated some synthetic password data and tried running all of our software on it so that we could debug it before we set it back. All right, so this produced all sorts of interesting data, and I want to show you a taste of some of the data. This is our most fun graph of our paper. So, here's what you're going to see. On the bottom axis, this is the guess number on a log scale. So this is telling you how many guesses we're making for these passwords. And then on the y-axis is we're seeing the percentage of passwords that are guessed. So a line that's lower means that fewer passwords are being guessed. The line that's higher on the screen, the green line, higher percentages of passwords are being guessed. The question here is, what are these lines? Each line represents a different college at our university. So anybody have a guess as to what the which college would be represented by which line? Green is computer science, you think. So computer science bachelor's or guess is what?
Okay.
Well, so green is not computer science. Green is business. So it turns out that computer science passwords are 1.8 times stronger than business school passwords. Often people think that the bad one would be the arts or humanities, but they're kind of in the middle. So we don't know actually why this doesn't show causation, but it does show correlation. We also looked at a lot of other demographics. We found no effect for faculty, students, staff, or age. We found a very small effect for men. We also found that one of the big drivers was the decomposition of the password itself. So for each character you added to make your password longer, it became 1.4 times stronger. We also found that if you put digits in your password, putting them in a common location was not very helpful. So if you put your your digits at the end, which is where most people do it. Now let's compare that to putting it in another place. If your digit is at the beginning, it's 1.3 times stronger. If your digit is in the middle, it's twice as strong. And if you have more than one digit and they're spread out, not all clustered together, it could be 5 times as strong. Often people say, oh, my password is strong, I put a digit and a symbol in it. But what we found is that actually it matters a lot where in the password you put your digit and symbol. And the end is weakest for capital letters, the beginning is the weakest. We also looked at the survey results when people were creating passwords, and we found that people reported that that creating the password was annoying, their password was weaker. So you don't want people to be annoyed when you ask them to create a password. We also wanted to compare these passwords with the passwords we collected in our mechanical Turk studies. So we had our real CMU passwords. We had two different mechanical Turk studies. One was a study where we asked people to pretend that they were a Carnegie Mellon student creating a password on mechanical Turk, and they had to follow the same CMU requirements. And then we had another one where it wasn't, it didn't say anything about CMU, but they had similar requirements. We also looked at leaked passwords that were leaked in the plain text. But we also had passwords that were leaked, encrypted, or hashed, and then cached. Here you can see the leaked plain text are the red line, and the CMU passwords are the black line. The red line and the pink line. So you can see the pink line is actually pretty close to the black line. So here we have a leaked password set, stolen password set, pretty close to the practicality of CMU passwords. But then the CSDN and the Yahoo ones are actually not really all that close. So what we saw here is if somebody gives you a stolen password set and you want to know how close is it to real passwords, well, I don't know. Some of them are really close and some of them are not. On the other hand, the online studies are those green lines. And statistically, those are actually closer to the black line. So we found that if you have a choice of using our methodology for online studies versus just picking whatever random leaked password set you can come by, you're going to do better with our online study data as far as getting something closer to reality. So that was good to see, and suggests that. Using Mechanical Turk to collect password data is actually a pretty reasonable way to go. Okay. So once we have these studies, let's look at how we use them to evaluate password composition policies. So we ran these studies where we asked people to create passwords under different conditions. So here are some examples. So we have the basic 8 condition where as long as it's at least 8 characters, nothing else matters. And then we have the dictionary 8 condition, same thing, except it can't be a dictionary. And we had the comprehensive 8, which was like the CMU policy. And then we had basic 16, anything you want as long as it's at least 16 characters. And it did allow people to have very simple passwords like password, but hey, it's long. From these studies, we also looked at what symbols are people putting in passwords. And you can see that there are a lot of symbols on the keyboard, but there are a small number that people are using a lot. And that also helps explain why you don't get quite as much strength from symbols as you might expect. Okay, here's one of our early studies, and you can see all the different conditions and what the lines show about this ability. So we can see that at the end of our cracking, the comprehensive 8 and the basic 16 are doing the best. We have the least amount of cracking of those two. You can look at that and say, well, they're both pretty strong. You could use either one of those policies and it would be pretty strong. So then we looked at the usability metric. We had this is just showing creating passwords for the study was annoying and creating passwords for the study was difficult. And And if you look, Comprehensive 8 and Basic 16 are the most annoying and most difficult, but they're also the strongest. But we can also see that Comprehensive 8 is actually more annoying and more difficult even than Basic 16. So if you want something strong but usable, you're going to be better off with Basic 16, according to these usability metrics as well as some of the others that we looked at. So we went back and again looked at Comprehensive 8 and Basic 16, and Basic 16 is the strongest. But if you look at the whole graph and not just the right side, you see that early on, we're actually guessing a lot of Basic 16 passwords. And so that's a low-hanging fruit. So basically, we have some people who are creating long but really guessable passwords, and those are guessed early on, and then the rest of them are good. And what are those passwords that were guessed early on? Here's some of them. So this suggests that the idea of a 16-character password is good, but you have to have some restrictions. Hopefully not as many as we had in the comprehensive condition, but you need some restrictions so that people will not do kind of stupid things. So then we looked at, well, what else could we add? And so we tested a whole bunch of different policies, different lengths, the idea of saying you have to have basically two words with a symbol breaking them up, you have to have at least three character classes, and we compared that against that Comp 8 policy. So we made lots more graphs, and you can see here Comp 8 is actually among the worst that we tested now. So we found a whole bunch of policies that security-wise are better than that Comprehensive 8 policy. But then when we go look in the middle of the graph again, we again see this low-hanging fruit problem, and we find that there are only a small number of policies that are actually avoided. And our best seems to be this 3 plus 16. So that's 16 characters long, and you have to use 3 out of 4 character classes. That seems to be the strongest. But what about usability? So we see that if you look at how long it takes to create the password, that 3 plus 16 is actually significantly better than Comp 8. But if you look at how long it takes to enter the password, it's significantly worse. Why? Because it takes twice as long to type 16 characters as it takes to type 8 characters. Plus, there's more opportunity to make typos. On the other hand, we find that 3 class 12 is not quite as bad for password entry time, and it seems to be kind of in a sweet spot. All right, so we then went through and looked at what other different policies could we test. We came up with what we call 2List 12. This basically says that you have to have at least 2 character classes, and it has to be at least 12 characters long, and your password can't be on this list. And this is the list of the most common things people do in passwords. So rather than a blacklist of 300,000 common passwords, these are things people do, like have keyboard patterns, have pattern 1, 2, 3. Have 4 sequential characters in the alphabet, things like that. When we tested that, we found up there we have our 3 class 12, and we found when we used that blacklist that it actually was significantly stronger. We also tested something that was stronger still, and this was what we called our pattern requirement. The pattern requirement is that you can't put your special character at the beginning or the end. Just start your password with a lowercase letter. Super strong. If everybody would do that, it forces you not to have your special character at the end of the password or your capital letter at the beginning. But then when we looked at usability, the pattern stuff, that's all that red area, that's all the not usable. So very strong, terrible usability. On the other hand, that list condition is, again, is in that sweet spot of it's not the most usable, but it's not nearly as bad as some of the others. So we've been continuing to iterate on these different composition policies. And as we got into these longer passwords, One of the concerns we have is maybe one of the reasons that we're not cracking the longer passwords is that our cracking algorithms are not optimized for long passwords. And there were no cracking algorithms available, and we looked at what was published. Nothing available that was really optimized. And so we developed it ourselves. And we developed some password crackers, which we actually entered into the password cracking contest at DEF CON a couple years ago, and won. So we have some confidence that these are, you know, state-of-the-art approaches to password cracking. But one of the things that we did was instead of, as we cracked the password, treating each character as an individual item, we said, what if the algorithm is aware of n-grams? So it knows something about the structure of a password. Because as your password is longer, it might not just be a word, it might be a string of words or a phrase. And so we collected n-grams from a bunch of big corpora. We used that as part of our training. And then we were able to start cracking things that we couldn't crack before. So, you know, as an example, 3 plus 16, we were not able to crack this password, but once we extended our training, my body lies over the ocean was easily cracked, or I'm sexy and I know it, number 01, again, was easily cracked. So, speaking of passphrases, we started investigating that because, largely because of this XKCD.
Yes.
So this came out a few years ago, and people who knew that I was doing password research were like, oh, you can stop your research now. This is solved. Solved problem. Just do what the cartoonist said. And we're like, well, you know, I like XKCD too, but I would like to see the data to know that this actually works. And, you know, basically what he's suggesting is that instead of trying to follow these rules and make a password, what you should do is just pick 4 random words, string them together, and you have a really strong passphrase. So we decided to do a study. And we study system-assigned passphrases versus passwords. Why system-assigned? Well, people are not really very good at doing anything randomly. So if you ask people to pick 4 random words, they really can't do that. So we had to pick them for them. And so we compared a number of different randomly assigned strings of words with randomly assigned strings of characters. We did this as a Mechanical Turk study, and we had 8 different passphrase conditions and 3 different password conditions on Mechanical Turk. So here's one of our conditions. This is the 4 common words condition, and this gives you passphrases like try there, 3 come. We looked at that and we said that just doesn't seem memorable. Those words are too common, there's nothing connecting them. So then we tried the noun, verb, adjective, noun condition to make something more sentence-like. Plan, build, sure, power, end determines red drug. Okay, that seemed plausibly like it might be more memorable. These are examples of system-assigned passwords. Note this is shorter, it's the same equivalent strength as the passphrases, but it because it's a larger character set, it can be much shorter. And then we said, well, there's really nothing memorable about that, so what if they were pronounceable? And we found a pronounceable password algorithm from like 30 years ago, and we implemented it, and we got things like 250 and Vadasabi, which do kind of roll off the tongue a bit more. The result of this study was actually that there was no clear favorite. So it turns out that, in general, passphrases are not actually easier to remember, and they take longer to type in, and people make more errors while typing. We observed that you could probably deal with the errors through some error correction algorithms, which we showed would allow you to correct the errors without loss of security, so that would help. We also saw that the pronounceable passwords, which my students all hated, my students thought that the pronounceable passwords were the most ridiculous thing they'd ever seen, they actually did okay, people liked them. We also observed that none of these passwords are super strong, and if we were going to a stronger password, which might require, say, 16 random characters or a 10-word passphrase, we speculate that maybe at that point a 10-word passphrase would actually be more memorable, but we haven't actually run that study. they came into the lab and we asked them to create passwords for these three fictitious accounts and think aloud as they did to tell us what they were doing, why they were creating these passwords. And then we asked them some questions about what they thought about the security of these passwords. And I don't have time to go into detail, but a few of the interesting things we found. People think keyboard patterns are secure. People would say, look, I went diagonally across the keyboard, down and up, isn't that clever? I can remember it, and it's so secure, no one would ever think of that. And in fact, lots of people do this, and it is among the first things that is in the various hacking dictionaries. People also thought that adding a symbol made their password secure, and we actually had somebody say, I added an exclamation point to the end, and it makes it secure. So people will create a password which is clearly not secure, and then say, yeah, I know it's not secure, so I'm going to just add the symbol in the end. Now I have a secure password. Right? And that is totally a misconception. It was also interesting to see that people know they're not supposed to use dictionary words, and some will believe that dictionary words are never secure. However, if you create a password like jungle salmon 711, that's actually not a bad password, because jungle and salmon are like pretty much unrelated. And if this is a random number, it would be better if the number was in the middle and not at the end, but this actually scores reasonably well. But the person who created it said, yeah, I don't think this password was actually very secure. We also had people who misunderstood the attackers and what attackers would do. So there's somebody who made their password Mahavishnu because their favorite band was the Mahavishnu Orchestra, and they said it's secure because the band name is hard to spell. Like somehow that would, you know, deter the attackers. And then there was somebody who made their password Goldie because their dog's name is Goldie. And they said, well, I haven't actually put that on my Facebook account, so therefore no one would know my dog's name is Goldie. You know, irrespective of the fact that there are a lot of golden retrievers named Goldie out there, and so it's a popular password. So then we did an online study to look at people's perceptions of password security. And we're going to have a little audience participation here. So we showed people two passwords, and we asked them which one was more secure or whether they were equally secure. So you guys get to vote with a show of hands between which one is more secure or whether they're equal. So show of hands if you think I love you 88 is more secure than I eat kale 88. Show of hands if you think I eat kale 88 is more secure. And what if you think they're equally secure? Okay, so our participants in our study thought they were equally secure, but that's actually a misperception. I eat kale 88 is actually a lot more secure than I love you 88. Right, they're the same number of characters, they have the same number of numbers, they're the same numbers, they're the same place. But it turns out that I love you is one of the most common phrases in passwords. I eat kale is not common. Sadly, I like kale. So it turns out that this makes being a common phrase makes a big difference. All right, try this one. We have Brooklyn 16 and Brooklyn QY. Right? Who thinks Brooklyn 16 is more secure? Who thinks Brooklyn QY is more secure? And who thinks they're equally secure? All right. So our study participants thought that Brooklyn 16 was more secure because it has numbers in it, and everybody knows you're supposed to have numbers. But in fact, Brooklyn QY is more secure in this case because QY is not related to Brooklyn. It's essentially two random letters that are put on the end. Adding a number on the end of a password is a very common thing to do. So we found our participants weren't all wrong. They did know to avoid some common words and names, but they didn't recognize common phrases like I love you. They knew that digits and symbols would add strength to a password, but they overestimated it and didn't realize that the position made such a difference. We also asked them how many guesses they thought their password would have to withstand an attack, and we got answers that ranged between 2 and 10 to the 16th. So they're all over the place. So, you know, the reality is that even in a small-scale guessing often people can try multiple times. Even if they get locked out, they can come back again multiple times. And if somebody does an automated attack where they have multiple IP addresses guessing your password, you could probably guess a million guesses before you got completely shut down. The large-scale guessing attacks, as we've discussed, can easily guess like 10 to the 14th passwords. Now we also saw that one of the reasons for these misconceptions is probably the feedback that people get. Now this is typical when you create a password. This is the feedback. Your password is weak. Create a stronger password. Right? That's not really giving you much useful information. And we've seen that the meters themselves are often wrong. Based on our data, when it tells you your password is good or bad or whatever, many of them, it's really giving you pretty bogus information. So we looked at password meters feedback and guidance. We looked at a lot of password meters. And we decided to do some tests, again set up as these Mechanical Turk tests. So we looked at things like visual differences between password meters. These are all showing exactly the same score, but you can see some of them are fat, some are thin, some of them are green the whole time, some of them change colors. We even had one we tested that instead of looking like a line that filled, it was a dancing bunny. And as your password gets better, the bunny dances faster and faster until he like has a connection and jumps off your passwords that all looked visually the same but had different scoring meters. So this is all showing the same password, but some of them are giving it a higher score than others. And as you can see, as we type more of this password, some of them now are like, it's great! And some of them are still 4, 4, 4. And see that 1/3 score meter? Look how long that password was before it went all green. So we ran our study, we got our graphs. What we found is that visual differences basically don't really matter. the passwords were equally strong, regardless of whether it was a dancing bunny or a fat or a thin or a color meter. And they were all better than not having a meter at all. But some of the different scoring mechanisms actually led people to have stronger passwords. So basically, if you withhold praise and make them type longer before they actually are told they have a good password, people will try harder, to a point. If you make it too hard, eventually they give up and they're like, this is stupid, I never get to it. Yeah?
Do the meters like lock people out if it's not secure enough, or is it just a suggestion?
You can go either way. In this study, there was a very low minimum, and once you passed that low minimum, then it was just encouraging you to go stronger. So as I mentioned, real password meters out there in the wild do things like tell you password 1 exclamation point is a good password because it has a number and a symbol, and they give you unhelpful feedback. So we decided to design a new meter that would actually have accurate scoring and data-driven feedback to users. We wanted to do this without having to have people send their password over the internet in order to get it scored. So we developed a neural network approach to estimating the strength of passwords that could be done in a web browser, a very small amount of code. This was presented at Usenet Security last year and won the Best Paper Award. Then we looked at how can we provide intelligible explanations. We couldn't provide intelligible explanations out of the neural network, so we had to have heuristics supplement the neural network to provide these explanations. And so we wanted things like, this is your password you're typing, it's unicorns with a zero in the middle. It would tell you, don't use simple transformations of words or phrases. And because that's something that many of the hacking dictionaries account for. And then here, capitalize the letter in the middle rather than the first character. So we had 21 different heuristics of things we were looking for that had feedback associated with them. And then we ran an analysis to figure out how much weight we should give each heuristic in coming up with a score. So this is the meter we created, it's the main screen, and once you exceed that, then you have advice. And so your passwords are certain colors, and you have different feedback. And you can click to get more information, and we have more information about creating passwords. So we did an evaluation. Again, we did it with Mechanical Turk, and we had about 5,000 people, and we had different conditions. We had two different password policies that we tested, and we also tested different stringencies. So we had a low stringency, a medium, and a high, where the color of the bar, depend on how good your password was before you found out the good bar. So we also tested no feedback, paired that with feedback where you got a bar, a colored bar, but no words, and then a condition where you had a standard amount of feedback, and then standard feedback, which also included showing you your password on the screen and edit it to show you a better password. And then we had a version where it didn't show you your password on the screen. Here's how it looks in action if somebody's typing. Let's see if they back up, they try something else, and they finally get a good password. So here's some of our results when you have no feedback. And then the same policy, but with either just the bar or with the words. The just the bar is the blue one, the purple line has the words. And you can see that providing feedback is improving this part of the password. We found that the feedback did not impact memorability. And however, the more feedback we gave people, the more difficult and annoying they reported the task, because they were like trying to be good, and they did find that difficult. And we found that all of the features, when we look at them separately, had some value. We now have an open source release of this password reader on our website, on GitHub. And you can also see the online demo of our meter. So I encourage you to check it out. Like I said, it will run in your browser. And so that is something available. Right, one more thing I want to mention before I wrap up, and that is password expiry. Take a picture of that too. people often, when I give these talks, people often ask me, the first question in the Q&A, how often should I change my password? How often should I force my employees to change their password? And I would say, oh, never. And go on to the next question. And people will be like, what did she just say? Never? And it turns out that there is research, and most of this is not even my own research, but other places have done this, that have found that it's actually counterproductive to mandate password changes. So when I was at the FTC, they tweet a lot at the FTC and a lot of security advice, and they tweeted this. And I said, no, why are we tweeting this? This is not good advice. And the PR people who tweeted it said, well, you know, the government would have to change our passwords every 60 days, so must be good. And which is just ridiculous. And so I went to the IT office and I said, why do we have to change our password every 60 days? And they didn't know why. It's best practice. Of course we have to do that. So I showed them some of the research that suggests that this might not be a good idea. And they were like, really interesting. So one of my biggest contributions to the Federal Trade Commission was getting them to change that policy. The FTC staff love me now. But it's not just the FTC saying this. We frequently see things like this. And I'm like, passwords are not like underpants. Like, you should change your underwear. You don't need to change your password. I wrote up a blog post about this. And I put it on, it was on the front page of the Federal Trade Commission website. And it got a lot of attention there. There were a lot of news articles written about this. And a lot of people sent this to their system administrators and said, see, we shouldn't have to change our password. Now, if you've had a breach, yes, please change your password. But having a regular every 60, 90 days doesn't make sense. The reason that people say that you do need to change your password that often is this threat model. If actors that are in your system and you don't know they're there. You change your password, flushes them out. That's the idea. However, most people, when they change their password on a regular basis, they don't pick something random. They take the old password and they change it. They transform it in some small way. So this was a study done at University of North Carolina. They're the Tar Heels, so they found that people will capitalize a letter in their password. They will add digits to the end. They will increment digits. They will insert digits. They will take, people are very clever. They'll say, oh, there's a one in my password. I'll make it an exclamation point because that's the same key as the one. Or they will take the date they had to change their password and just append it to the end. At UNC, they got access to passwords for 10,000 defunct accounts. And at UNC, they were changing passwords every 3 months, so they were able to get a string of the same user's passwords. The first thing they did is they cracked them. So they had about 8,000 accounts that they cracked. And then they developed a machine learning algorithm to try to determine if you know one of somebody's passwords, can you predict their next password? They got some really impressive results here. So 17% of accounts were cracked in less than 5 guesses using their algorithm. And in their offline attack, which they only gave themselves 3 seconds to do per account, 41% of accounts were cracked within 3 seconds. Right, so that's just from knowing one password that someone has, being able to predict their next password. So this suggests that if somebody is in your system and knows the passwords and then you change them all, easily they're going to come back in for at least 41% of your accounts. And in reality, an attacker probably will have more than 3 seconds. So it seems that your benefits of expiry are actually pretty limited, and you'd be much better off focusing on like slow hash functions, something like that, which doesn't impede users. We also found there's a lot of survey evidence that suggests that users get really annoyed by having to change their passwords on a regular basis, and we know that that causes them to create weaker passwords to begin with. So I'm not the only one saying this. In the UK, their security office has come out with recommendations against regular expiry. In the US, the National Institute for Standards and Technology has come out with this in their draft regulations. We're hoping in the next few months they'll come out with final regulations that also say this. So, to wrap it up, as was mentioned in the introduction, I also make quilts. And a few years ago, I made this quilt, which is visualizing the 1,000 most common passwords from the Rocky data breach. It's called Security Blanket. And while I was making this quilt, I was thinking about passwords in my research. The passwords are all scaled according to their frequency in the data set, and they're color-coded. And the color-coding was entirely manual. So I went through each of those 1,000 passwords and tried to put it in a cluster. And there's some that are fairly obvious. So all the love-related words are red, and all the love words are blue. But there were some that, you know, I pondered, why is this here? So there's Justin, right? Is that like the user's name, is it the boyfriend's name, is their son's name, or are they just a Justin Bieber fan? I don't know. Princess. Like, people like Disney princesses. Maybe they call their girlfriend the princess. And then I realized that if you look on the list of the most common pet names in the United States, princess is on the top of both dog and cat names. Lots and lots of love. You can see all that red. It's really big. There's also some profanity. If you look carefully, you will see there's profanity. It's kind of a gold color. But there's a lot more love than hate. So that's nice, right? But it also suggests something, a weakness. It's just something, if you're an attacker, you know, guess nice things. Of course, guess all the bad things. There's also a lot of monkeys. It's like, if you look under the word pass in arms, there's monkey. Monkey is the most common animal. And if you look on other people's lists of the most common passwords. Monkey comes up a lot. And so I kept saying to my students, why is this? Why are there so many monkeys here? And my students were like, I don't know, whatever. And I'm like, no, we need to find out. So we did an MTurk study. We had about 8,000 participants. It was one of the other studies I showed you. But we instrumented it, so anytime anyone created a password with monkey in it, it would add a question to the survey and ask them why there was a monkey in their password. So we had 8,000 participants, we caught 17 monkeys. And basically people said they liked monkeys. I have a friend whose nickname is Monkey. I really like monkeys. So that was the only insight we got, was people create passwords about things they like. So we need to find ways to help people feel good about passwords, but not be so predictable and not put monkeys in their passwords. So we'll stop there.
Thank you so much. It just points out to me how little fun I'm having with my own research. You're clearly having too much fun. We have time for some questions.
So we tested many different password cracking algorithms. I didn't have time to get into it, but we actually did one paper that compared password cracking algorithms. Whenever we collect data, we usually run it through multiple different password cracking algorithms. One thing we did actually in the test of password cracking algorithms, there are people you can hire to crack passwords for you, even legally. But companies will hire them to test the strength of internally. And so we hired one of those companies, and we gave them a set of passwords that we had cracked with our algorithm, and we asked them to crack it. And basically what we found was that by running a combination of algorithms, we could achieve about the same as what these best human attackers could achieve. And so now our kind of gold standard that we use is a combination.
Out of curiosity, I understand that you have used many different passive cracking algorithms, but in a lot of your talk, you mentioned about those ones that are trainable, and most of them being trained using the disclose or leak password data sets.
Yeah.
But the thing is, all those, what they try to crack, they're able to learn whatever the distribution of that leak file was. Versus if you were to create a file that it was following your rules of distributions, not just rule-based system, still being a learning system, and you would have to create a corpora of passwords based on your usability.
Yeah, we do actually do that. So when we train it, there's a lot of password data out there. So we extract from that only the passwords that comply with our rules. And we train it only with the passwords that comply with our rules. Because there's no point guessing a password that only comply with our rule, because it can't possibly be in the password set. Yeah. So we do that. Now, that said, when we have these funny rules, there aren't that many passwords that comply with these weird rules. And they are probably created by people who just randomly created a password that complies with the rule because they weren't actually given that rule to create a password with. And so we know that there's some discrepancy between if you're told your password has to be 16 characters and contain 3 digits and you just happen to have it versus you did it because you had to do that. We try to account for it. So somebody else has already done this. There's a password called Have I Been Pwned? never seen it, I highly recommend
that, actually Troy Hunt is the guy behind that website, but this is something that
to collect data. So we actually that would be a questionable ethics. I don't think our ethics review board would allow us to do that. So in all of these cases, we're very careful not to collect people's real passwords unless we have their permission. So I think if we told people, you know, type in your password and we're going to store it, I think people would be much less likely to want to type in their password. And if we stored it without telling them, that would clearly be unethical. Although, interesting with the password meter, I took it to, they had kind of like a science fair over in a congressional office building a few months ago in D.C. And there were a few senators, but mostly it was the staff of congresspeople came to see this cool stuff. And I brought our password meter over there on my laptop, and I invited people to try it out. And I would say, like, you know, make up a password and test it. And people are like, oh, I'll put in my real password. I'm like, no, don't do that. I'm like, I'm not storing your password, but you just have to trust me. So really, you shouldn't go typing your password without other people's passwords.
Well, I use my password check in your website testing.
Okay. Okay, I didn't store it, so you're good. Because we realized that, hey, our research was suggesting longer passwords, these algorithms aren't optimized for longer passwords, we better make one that is. But yeah, it doesn't end there, it keeps going. And so I think that having people change their password to adapt, you know, tightening password policies, increasing mandatory length, may make some sense. Not doing it on a schedule, by any means. The other thing, though, is that as you add length to your criteria, so they have to be like longer passwords, you are increasing the password space. So it is going to make it that much harder to guess, even if you know what the algorithm is. So it is an arms race, but length helps you stay one step ahead. Ultimately, where does this end? I think this has to end with something other than passwords, eventually. In the short term, I think where this is maybe going is that we all actually pick random passwords and we use a password manager to help us remember them. I started using a password manager, doing this work, it's made my life much better. I do recommend that. Yeah?
Well, my question is going to be related to that. In one of your slides, you looked at data that compared usability and user frustration and whether users stored the data. And my question was going to be if you included password managers that store data or just simply physical storage like that.
We included password managers as stored, but in our data set, there are very few people who use password managers. So the question of how you define a password manager, having your web browser remember it is a form of a password manager, and a lot of people do that. Very few people actually use the good, secure password manager, but we do take into account both writing down and storing in some sort of a password manager.
Last question.
So you mentioned that password annoyance slowly doesn't make your password, but then the more rules you have, the stronger the password is. So you kind of mentioned a little bit where you were
So we think there are some sweet spots. So the study that we did where we found that password annoyance correlates with your password, everybody has the same policy, but some people, for whatever reason, are more annoyed than others. I think you know what we concluded from the MTurk studies is you probably don't want to be at the policy that is just super annoying to everybody. But if you go to the policies that everybody says is fun and easy and whatever, you're not going to have the security. So unfortunately, you're going to have to annoy people somewhat, unless you get rid of passwords, which would be nice, right? But I think there are sweet spots. I think also there are different phases of the password life cycle. So there's the creation phase, but then there's also the use phase. And it may be worth it to make it a little bit harder to create as long as it's not harder to use. So if you ask people to type, you know, a 50-character password, that's going to be annoying every time you use it. Although it may be easy to come up with something that's 50 characters long. So those are all trade-offs that you have to look at.
So I'd like to thank you once again. I'm sure you saw by the questions that there's huge interest in all of this. It's a very topical kind of thing right now. I'd like to remind everyone that the ICAL website features video recordings of most of our distinguished lectures, and those will be there for you to be able to enjoy and get more detail out of. And other than that, thank you so much for coming and for